Well, let's open our Bibles now to John chapter 3. We've been beginning a study verse by verse through the Gospel of John, which is wonderful because it's all about Jesus, and it's written so that we might believe in Jesus. You know, caterpillars don't live very exciting lives when you think about it. You kind of feel sorry for them. They never travel very far, and where they do go, it takes a tremendous amount of exertion for them. They just kind of grovel in the dirt. There were two caterpillars, however, making their way through the wet, muddy path, and one of them looked up, and he saw a butterfly flitting around and kind of caught in the breeze, and he looked at it, and pretty soon it was flying out of sight. And he turned to his companion in the mud and said, "You'd never get me up in one of those things." You know, they couldn't understand the change of nature that had occurred. The butterfly had been just like them at one point, but it was changed. It had a new life. You could say it was born again. And we could ask the question, am I a caterpillar or am I a butterfly? There was a man who came to Jesus who didn't know he could have a changed life. And so let's look at John chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And this man came to Jesus by night and he said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher. For no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered and said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? He can't enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be amazed that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus represents a lot of people. He is as close as you could get to a good person. And Jesus said to him, what he said to him is relevant for all of us who are seeking answers. This is a story of a man who had it all. Look at verse 1. "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews." The Bible says that Nicodemus was a Pharisee. Now we often think of the Pharisees and we think of them as people that were not that great because of Jesus' criticism of them. But that's not fair, you see, because, okay, I won't do that again. It's my last chance anyway. It really isn't, because they were very religious, very devout. The problem was some of them were hypocrites, but they devoted their lives to obeying the word of God. They were very serious about it. To become a Pharisee, you would actually take an oath in the front of three witnesses saying that you would keep the law of God. And there weren't as many of them as you think. There were only about 6,000 of them in the nation of Israel at any time. And they were really tight brotherhood, very serious about keeping the law of God. Nicodemus was very religious. He had a strong faith in God. He kept the Sabbath. He kept all the feasts and the holy days. He would have tithed everything that he had, right down to the little leaves on the herb plants and giving 1 out of 10 to the Lord. So serious. And he would have had huge portions of the scriptures memorized. I frankly think that he might have had all of the Old Testament memorized. That would not be uncommon for a man like Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a brilliant man and a great scholar. Jesus Jesus is able to talk to Nicodemus in a way that you don't hear him talking to anybody else in the New Testament. He's able to use these symbolic ideas that nobody but somebody who had a great amount of training would be able to really clue on. It wasn't the common kind of teaching that Jesus did all the time. He was very wealthy. He was an aristocrat. Some believe that he was Nicodemus Ben-Gurion, who would be the brother of the historian Josephus, whom some of you have heard of, which would make his family one of the most famous in all of Israel and would make him actually one of the three wealthiest men in Jerusalem. James Montgomery Boyce remarked, he would have been even more important than Rockefeller, Astor, Einstein, or Eisenhower, for in one sense, he was all of these things in one. Nicodemus was also a politician. He was a member of the Sanhedrin, a group of 70 men, some of them scholars, some of them laymen. 70 of them who were actually the Supreme Court of Israel. And they had jurisdiction and authority over every Jew in the world. He was a part of that governing body. He was a famous religious leader as well. He's referred to as the teacher in Israel. Not a, but he is the teacher in Israel. Extremely brilliant, the most respected rabbi in Israel. Yet he comes to Jesus seeking. He had fame, he had money, he had power. He was deeply religious, but yet something was still missing in his life. Maybe it would be more accurate to say someone was missing from his life. Though he had all this stuff, there was still a hole in his heart. And look at verse 2. This man came to Jesus by night. So you could say it was Nick at night, right? Now, why did he come to Jesus at night? Now, generally, and this is what I taught for years, generally we say, well, he came to see Jesus at night because he was afraid that the people would see him if he was with Jesus. And so what he did was he snuck to Jesus in the nighttime. Didn't want his reputation tarnished in any way. But, you know, I don't think that was the reason why he went to see Jesus at night. I don't think that was it. I think he went to see Jesus at night because he's a busy rabbi. I mean, this guy was the number one rabbi in Israel, so he's teaching from dawn to dusk. Jesus is busy teaching from dawn to dusk. So when's the only time they're being able to talk? And that would be at night. Maybe he came to Jesus at night because he was a celebrity and there were fewer people around Jesus. He wouldn't have to be signing autographs, so to speak. And he and Jesus just could have some private time. It could be that maybe he couldn't sleep because of something Jesus had said. There was something he didn't understand. There was some point that he wanted to talk about with Jesus. I agree with Herbert Lockyer, who wrote, "We feel that he came by night because it was the best time for both Jesus and himself to have a quiet, uninterrupted conversation about spiritual matters. Nicodemus had been occupied all day with his teaching duties, and Jesus had been active in his out-of-door ministry. Now both could relax and talk through the night. It may be that Nicodemus had such a heart hunger that he could not wait until morning, and so he came running to Jesus as soon as he could." You know, it is so easy for us to be quick to judge someone. Just like Nicodemus has been judged. Well, he was a coward. Wait a minute, you don't know that. There's a whole nother reason why he'll come when he came to Jesus, right? Yeah. We have to be so careful that we don't judge people, make immediate decisions, judgment calls about them when we don't have all the information. All this being said, Nicodemus is the go-to guy in Israel. And if you had a Bible question, you Googled Nicodemus, and there was the answer. Nicodemus believed, though, that Jesus was a safe person to be able to talk to. I mean, where could Nicodemus go, really, and ask important life questions? His heart had been stirred by what he heard that Jesus had said and by what he had seen Jesus do. So where does he go? So he went to the source. And I just want to encourage you guys, you can come to Jesus with all your questions, with all your doubts, and maybe you feel like, well, I should know everything by now. Believe me, it's okay to have doubts and come to Jesus. It's okay to be in the church with doubts. It's all right. It's okay to have your questions. It's all right. Now, I'm going to tell you this. Jesus has the answer. The Bible does have the answers for the things that's disappointed you. Maybe you felt like God has let you down. I'm not exactly sure. Stay. Don't go. You're safe. Just like Nicodemus was safe going to Jesus with his questions, you're safe with Jesus today. Now in verse 2, it says, Nicodemus came to Jesus by night and he said to him, Rabbi, we know that you've come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. You know, maybe Nicodemus came to Jesus thinking he would have one of those rabbi to rabbi discussion arguments. You know, whenever you get two rabbis together, you have 10 opinions, exactly. And so maybe they're going to talk about some philosophical stuff, I'm not sure. Maybe he had a question, like I said. Jesus, would you please clarify what you said? But by addressing Jesus as rabbi, we know that Nicodemus respected Jesus. And there's a lot of people who feel that way about Jesus. Oh man, I respect Jesus. Jesus was a good man. Jesus was a great moral teacher. Jesus was the greatest man who ever lived. Or I really admire Jesus. But listen, Jesus did not say, admire me. He said, follow me. He didn't say, respect me. He said, follow me. That's what he's saying to you today. Follow me. It's not enough to just think good thoughts about Jesus. Jesus wants us to come to him and have a personal relationship with him. Now, many of the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem attributed Jesus' miracles to Satan. I don't know if you knew that. But they so disliked Jesus that they thought, well, how could anything he do has done come from God? And so what they did was, they said, when he healed someone, that's by the power of Satan. Somebody's who was blind could now see, that's from Satan. But that's not the way Nicodemus felt, because he says, Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher. Notice that he says, we, and not what? I. Which indicates, you're right, which indicates that there were other people in his same sphere, rabbis, Pharisees, same people who felt the same way. Maybe they weren't coming forward, but we know that you are a teacher sent from God. Jesus interrupted him, and I don't know how far they were actually into the conversation, but Jesus interrupted him, and he said in verse 3, truly, truly, I say, and before we go farther, we want to know what truly, truly means, because we never say that today. I don't say, truly, truly, I say to you, we go to lunch with me after church. We don't say that. But the word truly, truly, actually in Greek, it's amen, amen, which is amen, amen. So be it, so be it. Those are the words that you would say in court when you were, it would be like our saying, I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help me God. That was the oath. And so Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, Nicodemus, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Born again, it's the idea of change. It's the idea of a change deep down inside, the change that we all want to have. We try to change our lives. You might, you know, try to change your appearance. Maybe a new look, new hair color, new hair. You try all the products. Maybe it's, you know, it's some kind of a surgery on your body to make you look better. We're all looking for change, but you know, the biggest change that we need is a change inside. Nicodemus, we're not told how long he thought about what Jesus just said. But you know, before we go, I just want to say sometimes at this point, many people portray Nicodemus as some sort of dummy who couldn't figure out what Jesus was saying. But Nicodemus knew exactly where Jesus was going when he told him he must be born again. We're told that the rabbis had a saying, and it was this: a proselyte or a convert who embraces Judaism is like a newborn child. It's like someone who's just been born again. Jews would immerse themselves in a gathering of waters called a mikveh. And so let's say they became ceremonially unclean. They would go to the mikveh and they would go down under the water and they would come up out of the water. And the Jewish teaching was, you died and you came up born again. Did you know that? And so before the Sabbath, the men would go and they would go to the mikveh and they would go under the water and come up. Before some groups, before they even would open the word, they would do that. They would purify themselves. So Nicodemus knew the idea of being born again. It's a very common Jewish idea at the time of Christ. And they understood that you would come up as a newborn baby, as a newborn person. So when Nicodemus heard Jesus' words, he understood. Here's another thing. As we read verse 4, Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old?" I think this infers that Nicodemus was getting on in years. He was asking Jesus, "Hey, Lord, I'm kind of old now. I don't know if you can really change when you're old." Someone said there are certain telltale signs when you're getting old. They said, you know when you're getting old when happy hour is your nap. You suck in your gut and your ankles swell. You don't care where your spouse goes as long as you don't have to go along. Your idea of weightlifting is standing up. I love that, don't you? It takes twice as much time to look half as good. Someone says, you know, you're getting old when you look forward to a dull evening. Or when somebody calls you at 7 o'clock at night and says, did I wake you up? And I love this. You bend down to tie your shoes and wonder what else you can do while you're down there. Your teeth and you no longer sleep together. That, you know, those are signs. Those are some of the signs. You know, it's said that the longer you live, the more set you become in your ways. Nicodemus was getting old. There wasn't much time left. You might say, "Ah, okay, that's good. I'm young. I'm not 40. You know what? You don't know how long you're going to live. You might say, well, I think I'm going to live till I'm 80, you know, maybe longer, 90. I was talking to one of our ladies at church, and I didn't realize how old she was. And she says, well, I'm 92. My jaw dropped, because you would have lost a bet if you were to guess her age. No way, I said. You're not telling me the truth. No, she said, and most people don't, you know, lie about being 92. But she's living, and she's going to go on. She's going to hit the 100 mark. I know. You know, well, that might be true for some, but we don't know how many years we're going to live. We don't know if we're going to live tomorrow. I've told you before, I've shaken hands or hugged people on a Sunday after church, and something happens to them in the middle of the week. And I had no idea that would be the last time I would ever be able to tell them I love them. That's why the Bible says, prepare to meet your God. We don't know how much time we have. And anyway, you know, the insurance stats are in. Everybody's going to die, right? Listen, you need to be thinking about this now. And most people make their commitment to Jesus Christ when they're 18 years or younger. Did you know that? It's important now to make that decision for Christ. Jesus said you must be born again. Now, going back to Nicodemus's question here in verse 4, he said, he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he? Nicodemus is saying, wouldn't it be nice if it was as easy as going back and starting over? When you're talking about this is much more than stepping into the mikvah and going down and coming up. Do you feel like Nicodemus, maybe? Do you wish you could start over? I know a lot of us feel that way. If I could only begin again. If only life was like a video game. When, you know, you were wiped out in the game and you can just hit restart. And you can start the game all over again. Though we're not told, Nicodemus must have asked Jesus to help him understand how this change can happen. Something like, break it down for me, would you? What do you mean, Jesus? And in verse 5, Jesus says, this is what it means. Jesus answered, and again he says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Again, Nicodemus knew what Jesus was talking about. You see, John had been baptizing in water, John the Baptist. And John's baptism, some of you know, was a baptism of repentance. People would come to be baptized, and it was a baptism of repentance. John's message was, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus says, you can't be born again unless you're baptized in the water. That means in repentance. Nicodemus understood that. But he also said, not only repentance, but you must be regenerated and of the Spirit, he says. That speaks of regeneration. That means a brand new life. That's something we can't do ourselves. That's something that God does for us. There must be repentance of sin. And you know, that's not something we talk about very much. We invite people to come to Jesus, and we're not talking about you've got to turn from your sin. And it's not just acknowledge, oh, that was a bad thing, but you turn and you walk away from it. You say, I've put that behind me because I've got something better in front of me. That's what repentance is. And you realize that the things, the sins that we're turning from, those things are like the nails that nailed Jesus to the cross. Our sins, and we say, I don't want that anymore, and you turn away. That's repentance. And then the Holy Spirit comes and he does something we could never do for ourselves. He comes and there is this regeneration. There is this new birth. And you're no longer a caterpillar, so to speak. Now you're a butterfly. There's been this dramatic change in your life. Jesus goes on to explain the change in verses 6 and 7. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be amazed that I said to you, you must be born again. This radical change is not accompanied by human energy of any kind. It's a work of the Holy Spirit. Perhaps Nicodemus was asking, how can I know this has happened? What's the evidence of it, Jesus? Jesus goes on to say in verse 8, here's the evidence. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you don't know where it comes from and where it's going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. You know, we're not told so, but most likely Jesus and Nicodemus were talking on the roof, the patio, which they all would have on the rooftops of their house. It was cooler there. The breeze would be blowing. And most likely, as they're talking about this, there was a breeze that came up, and the leaves on the trees or the palm fronds, they began to move. Or maybe something, you know, on the street began to, you know, blow down the street. And Jesus, who was always looking for an illustration, wasn't he? He'd always take the opportunity for an object lesson. Jesus says, Nicodemus, this is the evidence. You don't see the Holy Spirit. You don't see him. He's like the wind, but you see the evidence. You see the evidence. How can I know? Well, you repent. And then you believe. And then you're born again. by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then you begin to see there's change. You see it on the outward. You know, I'm afraid that there are a lot of people who think they're born again and they're really not. I'm not trying to put any lack of assurance on anybody. Don't go there with it. But I think there's a lot of people, yeah, I'm a Christian. Well, why? Well, I've been a Christian. My family's been Christian, etc. But are you really born again? When we talk about having a personal relationship with Jesus, do you have the personal relationship with Jesus? Or is that something that you've just heard about and you've kind of filed over there, but, you know, I don't really have that? Well, that is what it means to believe in Jesus. And if you don't have the personal relationship with Jesus, then you're not born again. And Jesus says to Nicodemus, don't marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. You know, so many times when we're sharing the gospel with people, we invite them to Christ and we say, you know, no matter what you've done terrible things, you can come to Jesus, but you know, not everybody is that way. A lot of us are like Nicodemus. We are good. We haven't done, I mean, this man, he was a law-keeping great man. Jesus said, don't marvel that I say to you, good person, that you must be born again. You see, this gospel isn't for down and outers alone. This is maybe, I could say, for up and outers. It's for everybody. And you may have been a very, and you are a very good person, and you're moral, and you're outstanding, and people look up to you, but you must be born again in order to see the kingdom of God. And so the door is open wide for this to be your experience. You can't rest on family traditions. You can't rest on the fact that as a baby you were baptized because you didn't believe when you were baptized. Your parents did, but have you personally? Good person, you must be born again. That's what Jesus says, and you can have that experience. And I want to offer that to you. I'm just kind of the spokesperson for Jesus, but I want to give you that opportunity today to have that personal relationship with Jesus. And as we've heard Jesus say, he says, you must repent. It means turn away from the things, because even good people are struggling with something. Even good people have sin you need to turn from. And then he says you must believe. And then you know what happens? Jesus comes in and it's a spiritual work on the inside. And you are born again. And then you will have a personal relationship with Jesus. Because if you haven't had it, it's because you haven't been born again. Now, Jesus wants you to be born again. You come with your questions. You don't have to have all the answers. But Jesus is right there with you. So I'm going to give you an opportunity. Wherever you are right now, I'm going to give you an opportunity. You've already thought, God's Spirit has spoken to you, hey man, I need to turn away from this and this. Okay, I'm going to give you an opportunity now to invite Jesus to come into your life. And we're going to do that by prayer. The Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. To call on God means to pray. The Bible says that if we believe in our hearts that Jesus died for our sins, and we believe that he rose from the dead, and we've invited him to our lives, we will be saved, okay? So maybe you're a Nicodemus, maybe you identify with him, or maybe you can see how this born-again experience is open for you. What I want us to do right now is let's bow our heads, okay? Let's close our eyes wherever you are right now. You're at our central campus on the freeway. You're here. You're in this. Let's bow our heads. Pray for one another. Close your eyes. Let's just give other people privacy right now. But I want you to know that I don't believe there's any coincidence. I believe that of all the places you could be today and all the things you could be doing, you are here because Jesus brought you here. It's not a coincidence. It's a divine appointment. So you could hear this. And so I'm going to invite you now to pray with me. A prayer asking Jesus to come into your life. I don't want you to pray out loud though. Okay, just between you, me, and the Lord. But you pray this just between us. And you pray it with all your heart. Father in heaven, thank you for loving me and for sending Jesus to die for all the wrong things that I've done. I'm sorry for those things. I'm sorry for my sins. I believe that Jesus died for me. I believe that he was buried. And I believe that he rose from the dead for me. Please come into my life right now. Give me a brand new beginning. Change me. And right now, I accept you as the master, the ruler of my life, as my savior.